All of you, it's my honor to present today honorary doctor Andreas Gunnberg, who is going to talk about all this climate change and biofuel, and this is a hot topic that we have today. Andreas has a master's degree from Linköping University in biotechnology and has a long experience in the company, this Lantmännen, and for more than 15 years, working with the larger scale industrial processes and biological processes. And he's a former head of this innovation and technical project at this Lantmännen Agroethanol, and now work with the business developer for a sustainable perspective. I had the honor to work with Andreas for many years, almost a decade that we worked together. And then he had a lot of experience and development on this climate change, and also how to change the world actually from this unsustainable to a sustainable way. So it's I'm very happy to present Andreas, and we would like to listen to his presentation. Andreas.
Thank you very much, Mohammed, for those very kind words. It's been an honor also working with you, and I can say that I wouldn't be standing here today holding this seminar if it wouldn't be for you and your very competent research team. So my name is Andreas Gunnberg. As Mohammed said, I'm working as a business developer at Lantmännen Biorefiners. You see one of our three biorefineries here on the picture, this one located in Norrköping, which I will be describing a bit further up in my presentation. So the seminar of today, let's see if I could just get the technology working. Here we go. So the topic of today is resource efficiency and recovery, a key issue to stop global warming. And the agenda of the day is that I will start with just some facts regarding the global situation that we have at this point, and the sense of urgency that we're witnessing at this point. I'm going to address a little about the global situation from a raw materials perspective, and then move forward into energy consumption and to make some example in different value chains. After that, I will discuss a bit about circular flows and show some examples both from Lantmännen industry and other industries, and move forward to improved value chains using filamentous fungi, which is the work that we have been doing from Lantmännen side together with the University of Borås. And then I will finalize with some improvements also in carbon cycles, just to illustrate an additional example. So if we just start with some facts, then we all know that the global temperature is increasing. That's not something new, but it could be illustrated very clearly, and we see it also from our own perspective on almost daily basis. The global temperature is rising. We see glaciers melting, and also sea level is rising. We also see a fact that the atmospheric CO2 concentration is increasing, causing a higher greenhouse gas effect in the atmosphere. That could, of course, be a major part of this global warming aspect. And the third fact, we know that global CO2 emissions are steadily continuing to increase. You can see it from 1990s steadily increasing up to the late 2018. And the figures I'm showing here is that's just the direct CO2 emissions, not taking into account other greenhouse gases, such as methane gas and nitrous oxide, for example. So the world is in desperate need of change, and the reflection from my side is, of course, that time is running out and we need to act. So moving forward, if we go to Mother Earth, it's the home to 7.8 billion people. And looking of what it actually consists of, it's actually 71% that is oceans. So a major part is our seas or the oceans. If we look at the land, that's 29% then that is left, where of 10% is agricultural usage and 8% is forests. And if we then move forward to the global production that we actually have on the planet, we start on the agricultural side and we see that we have about 3.2 billion tons. It's always hard to take in all these big numbers, but I try to demonstrate it in an as illustrated way as possible. So I hope it could be understood. So 3.2 billion tons of maize, or corn, wheat, rice, etc. Above that, we also have quite big amount of sugar canes and sugar beets, 2.2 billion tons. Here it consists more of water and also quite a lot of fibers in this, which I will move forward to in the following slides in my presentation. So a higher amount of residues coming out from sugar canes and beets. And the similar is, of course, for fruit, vegetables, and others. You see, that's all. That's the highest amount. But we all know fruit vegetables are consisting of a lot of water and also some husks, etc., that is not cannot be converted to food for humans. And if we summarize these figures on a very approximate scale, this will give us a global production of food of about 4,300 kilocalories per capita. And that could be compared to the average food consumption if we then look at it on a global perspective, that is 2,950 kilocalories per capita. And here we also need to take into account that this is the total number that is consumed. It's not the amount that we actually eat, but it's the entire waste in the all over value chain. So we can see that the world is actually producing enough food for us to live and to be. So that's very good, of course. If we take the next step then, and to look at, besides the agricultural production, just as I said, we have the forests. So by 3.9 billion cubic meters of forests, that is actually in production. And this is, of course, a raw material for the pulp and paper industry, producing timbers, etc. And of course, we cannot eat forestry, but we can convert it just to have an understanding when we compare different things, since forests also, or kilocalories, is an expression of energy. When we talk about food, it's the energy that we actually eat. But just as an example from the forestry, if that would be used for combustion, for producing heat, for example, we could, from this, have about 1,400 kilocalories per capita. So about one third of what is being produced from the agricultural side, we could achieve from the forestry. So now we will go and leave the renewable raw materials and take the next step on how it actually looks today and add the fossil raw materials. So we are talking about the oil, coal, and natural gas. And here we see that it's total 11.5 billion tons usage each year, if we talk on oil equivalents, about 4 million tons of oil, the same on coal, and a little bit less on gas. And you can see that this is quite comparable to the amount which is produced from the agriculture side. But the thing is that this is much more energy dense. So it consists of a lot of more energy. And if we convert that to just be comparable, it's about 44,000 kilocalories per capita. So what we actually consume on a capita base, then we're up to 40,000 kilocalories per capita. And you can see that the amount that we actually consume from fossils is almost 10 times what we consume from agricultural sector. So what we need to actually survive is about one tenth of what we actually consume on a global perspective at this point. And this can be seen quite clear if we move forward and look on this picture here. This is the total energy consumption on a global scale. And we can see that it is drastically increased from the years 1900, basically, or early 20th century, up to where we are today. And if we take into account the increased number of world population, it has actually, the energy consumption has doubled from the 1950s to 2020. And also to see here, what is actually, what does the energy consumption consist of? We can see that in the bottom here, we have the traditional biomass that's burning and producing electricity, for example. But here we have coal, oil, and gas, which I demonstrated earlier. And on the very little top here, we have the renewables, such as hydropower, wind, and solar. And at this point, it still stands for a very little proportion of this. And we see here, if we look at the CO2 emissions by each sector, we see that electricity and heat is still the absolute majority polluter at this point and steadily rising, and together with the transport sector. And in order to cope with the situation that we have at this point, we need to decrease the overall energy consumption all through the value chain, and we need to replace the fossil usage with renewable alternatives. And in order to do that, in order to really decrease this, we really must look into the value chains to have as efficient value chains as possible in order to decrease the amount of raw materials that is actually needed in order to produce the energy or whatever it is. And just to illustrate this, I have an error with my computer. Let's see. Yep, thanks for that. Two examples to start with regarding value chain efficiency. If we start with the energy and transport, if we take a coal-fired electricity plant and look at the efficiency on that, if we say that we put in this energy amount of core, how much electricity can we receive? And the efficiency within that value chain is much less than 50%. And the rest of that is being converted into heat. Of course, this value chain can be being more efficient if we combine it in a combined heat and power plant, for example, which we will illustrate later in an example. But the efficiency is low. Another example is in the transport sector, of course. If we go from a fossil fuel and to a transport work on a truck or a car, we also know that the efficiency from the energy in the fossil fuel to the actual energy which we have for energy transport is also much less than 50%. So here we see, and these are, of course, just examples of inefficiencies that we need to take into account on how can we increase the efficiency all through different kinds of value chain to decrease the amount of raw materials that is actually needed. And just one example either. I talked a bit earlier about sugar canes when I said that there was about 2 billion tons of sugar cane. And if we look at just sugarcane, it consists of about 15% sugar and about 15% fiber. So there's a lot of water in this. But we also see that when we produce sugar and also molasses to some extent for the food industry, the major or a big part of this is actually the remains from that, which is called bagasse. And traditionally, bagasse is used as a heat just for heating purposes on the sugar mill itself. But in order to find good efficiency throughout that value chain, of course, we really need to look at additional things to do with that kind of raw material so that this raw material is not being just a waste. It goes into a biorefinery to produce electricity, it could be animal feed, could be renewable feed, which I also will show here. And I would like to demonstrate that with the classical waste hierarchy. you might have seen this earlier, but starting at the top, what must we do in order to decrease our footprint, or how to say, when it comes to raw materials? First, we must prevent all kinds of waste. That's the absolute first thing. And just one example, if we look at bread, which is a raw material that I will come back to in the presentation, we have about 80,000 tons of bread waste in Sweden every year. That's an enormous amount. And of course, that is the first thing. We need to prevent the waste from actually happening. And then moving down, of course, then we need to look at minimization and reusage. And this is something that I will illustrate in the following slides. But minimizing and usage is the one, reuse is, of course, to how can we reduce the number of raw material or reduce the amount of raw material that is actually needed for this purpose. And that could be used, for example, by using an industrial residue or waste from one industry going into raw material for another industry. And if we take the example once again here with the sugarcane that we discussed earlier, what we really want to do here is that we want the bagasse in this example not just to be a disposal and not just take it in for energy, but to be used so it could be replacing other fossil raw materials or other renewable raw materials in this kind of pyramid. So one example then on this is industrial symbiosis. And I want to demonstrate one example, which is taken from Norrköping and the Händelö Eco Industrial Park, which is a very good example, I think, and something that we are very proud of having here in Norrköping. So it's actually four companies in an industrial symbiosis. And if we start here with E.ON, which is the combined heat and power plant, they use forest residues and municipal waste from the city to produce heat, going back to the city, to produce electricity, and to produce steam. And the steam is sent to Lantmännen and Agroethanol, which uses grain and also industrial residues in order to produce ethanol, renewable carbon dioxide, and a protein feed. And the renewable carbon dioxide goes down to another company, AGA, which produces carbonic acid. And we also have a certain amount here, biogas substrate, which goes to another company producing biogas. So this is a very good example on how companies can actually collaborate in order to, on an overall perspective, reduce materials needed in their own setup. And this is one of the things that makes the products from Lantmännen and the biorefinery I just demonstrated to have a very low impact when it comes to the greenhouse gases and the greenhouse gas emissions. Another example to be addressed there is a circular flow within such an agriculture biorefinery. If we start on the agriculture side here, everything starts actually with the sun. So we use the solar energy in the agriculture in order to grow crops. And the crops is then sent to different industries. Some of it is sent to the biorefinery of agroethanol directly. And some of it is of course sent to mills producing flour. Some of the flour goes out to bakery to produce the bread. And what to be done then is that we could also, what we do in Norrköping is that we take the industrial residues both from the bakeries and also from the grocery stores and the stores, such as bread waste, bread that could not be sold the actual day goes back to the biorefinery and replace the grains to produce ethanol, CO2, and a protein feed. So this is also a very good and illustrative examples of a circular flow within the agriculture biorefinery, which decreases the need of raw materials in the chain. So we'll move into the next topic then and discuss and show and demonstrate a bit about the improved value chains using filamentous fungi, which is what we have done in the work together with Borås Högskola. So here we have the actual process at Lantmännen and Agroethanol. So as I described, we're using grain and industrial residues going in as raw material to the facility. These are being milled. This goes to a liquefaction and a fermentation, where we use a standard yeast in order to convert it to ethanol and to renewable carbon dioxide. Thereafter, we move to a distillation where ethanol is being produced, and what could not be converted to ethanol and carbon dioxide is being fed and dried and pelletized, producing a protein feed that actually goes back to the indirectly to the food value chain. So besides this, Lampanen has very recently also gone official with the next step in efficiency regarding their process. So also to come up even higher in, and not in efficiency, but in the value chain, they are taking the step now to produce wheat proteins for food application. So some of the proteins in the raw material will be separated out early up in the protein or in the process to produce wheat proteins for food applications. So in the work that we've done together with Borås, we have now looked at the possibility, how can we improve the overall process to produce even more ethanol from the same amount of raw material. So the situation that is at this point in Norrköping, we have quite a high amount of starch within our raw materials, which is being converted by the normal yeast to ethanol and carbon dioxide. But we also have some amount of hemicellulose and also cellulose within this raw material, which could not be converted by our normal yeast. So after the distillation, when the ethanol has been driven off and everything goes to the protein feed factory, if I put it that way, there are still potential raw materials that could be used, but not with our standard yeast. So instead, we have looked at a new setup with a new kind of cultivation using this filamentous fungi. And this filamentous fungi can use has a different setup, so it can convert hemicellulose and cellulose, but also other substrates to convert those to biomass for itself, but also to ethanol. So by incorporating this, we can actually increase the ethanol production using the same amount of raw materials with up, almost up to 5%. And at the same time, we can increase the value of protein feeds because we increase the amount of proteins in the protein feeds. It's getting higher concentrated. And we could also have decreased energy costs. So it's a very, very good and improved process with a very big potential. The next example I want to taste is from the project Ways to Taste, which is held by the University of Borås together with a number of stakeholders from the industry side, but also from the academy. And here, the object is to use different kind of industrial residues and also waste product together with filamentous fungi to produce new food products, but also biofuels and different feed components. So if we, for example, if we take the bread waste as another example, which we described earlier, it has demonstrated very clearly that if you have a bread waste out on the bakery, for example, you could add a cultivation of a filamentous fungi out on the bakery. So basically you have a small reactor where you feed in the bread waste, you have this cultivation on the filamentous fungi, and out of that comes something with a very nice texture and a very nice taste, which is actually suitable for a vegetal meat-like product. And what we've actually done in that case is that we've taken something that is in the food value chain, but it has it's going to come out from the food value chain if we do not do anything with it. But by doing this, we keep it in the food value chain and we let it take one more round. And it's a very, very good example on how we need to really act. The second example that I have is also within this, but a totally different aspect, and it's from the fish processing industry. So if we look at the fish industry, I'm going to go into the details of this, but it's a quite big amount of wastewater that's actually being in the production process of this. And this also holds quite a high amount of proteins. At this point, the proteins normally goes to a biogas process, which we see in the end here. But at the same time, if we could do the same here, which has also been demonstrated very nice, that we add a reactor and that we add a cultivation using this filamentous fungi, which you see here how they actually look, you could actually capture these proteins within the wastewater, allow the fungi to grow on that, and instead of having an energy source such as biogas, you could stay up in the waste hierarchy and produce animal feed instead, for example, replacing or decreasing the need of fish meal for this kind of applications. So these were three examples of filamentous fungi being used in different applications where we actually see a very, very good potential in order to decrease the footprint and or decrease the amount of raw material that is actually needed within these kind of processes. And the last example that I wanted to just demonstrate was another kind of carbon cycle or another kind of value chain. It's not just the value chains when we talk about energy that is crucial. It's also about looking at the cold carbon cycles, how much carbon dioxide or greenhouse gases is emitted in different chain. And just to illustrate this with one example first from the agriculture side, if we look at grain production, it's very normal that a certain amount of the straw or the residues is being left on the field as a soil improver, which is slowed down in order to create humus and to recover the carbon from the plant. So if you take anything, then on the longer perspective, you have a soil that is not that fertile. But the problem with this is that when you take back the straw, for example, it's only a small proportion that actually is being held in the ground as ground-bound carbon. Because what it does is typical decomposition in this, and in the decomposition it's just as we do in our compost back home, some of it is being left as compost, but the majority is being produced as CO2 being emitted to the air. And in this example we have about just little less than 20% of the carbon within the straw that is actually on a long-term perspective being as ground-bound carbon on a long-term perspective. And the majority goes up in the air as CO2. And of course, this is a circular system, and the CO2 which is being emitted is then taken up by a new crop that is being grown. So it's a natural system. So it's not a fossil emission in that perspective. But if we just take another example, could we improve this? How much of the carbon that is actually being taken into the soil? And just to illustrate, this is just an example, but we know that there are other products that are much more stable when being put in the ground, such as biochar or biocoal, where you can see figures up to almost 75% of the coal being long-term stored in the ground. So what could be done, just as an example, instead of sending the straw strictly back to the field, you could send it through a pyrolysis process, for example, where you produce a pyrolysis oil, which could be refined and to be used as a renewable fuel. When doing this, you also will have some pyrolysis gas, so you could produce electricity and you could use and also produce heat, could be used for heating of stables, etc., or even small cities. And the third product then is the biochar. So by doing with this just illustrative examples, we could have the same amount of carbon being fed back to the soil as a soil improver. And at the same time, we actually produce renewable fuel, electricity, and heat. So just an example of how we really must think, and that we must think on a very broad perspective, and it's a requirement also that we sit together in groups with very big also experience in a number of fields. And I'm very glad that we have demonstrated this together with the university, of course, and I think that this work that we've been doing with the filamentous fungi is a very good example of a very good cooperation between the industry and the academia. So that was my last slide. I want to thank you for all for listening, and it's not all in black, and together we can really make a change. So if there are any questions, feel free to put that in the chat. And could be, of course, both in English and in Swedish.
Okay, so thank you very much, Andreas. A very interesting presentation. So that I would like to start with a question, and then we will see that if there will come also other questions or not. If you consider that, I'm thinking about the beginning of your presentation, that you talk about this climate change and also this carbon dioxide, the production and all those greenhouse gases, and also the role of this resource recovery here to improve. Well, what do you think that in all these industrial processes that what we will have if we're going to be realistic in 10 or in 30 years until 2030 or 2050? I'm thinking both in Sweden and globally. What do you think that the realistic trend is going on?
I think that it is, of course, a very, very hard questions to answer, but what we really need first on a global perspective is that we need to set targets that are high enough on what we really must achieve, and that these targets must be fed down into regulations which are also very clear for the industry in order to act on, because it's these kind of things that actually is crucial for the industry really also to do something different. I'm very positive that there are a number of very good examples. For example, if we take another example, the Swedish steel industry and producing a fossil-free steel, just as one example. But we must keep in mind that all of these things, they come to a higher price. And somebody has to pay this higher price if it's not to be done from a regulatory way where it's actually being said that this we need to do. But if everything is put into place, I'm very certain that there's a huge potential to make these kind of changes and also make them quite rapidly, because there is a huge amount of experience out there, but everything needs to be, we need to do it together.
Yes, thank you. And so not so easy question, but a very interesting answer. So I wonder if there is any other questions or in both in Swedish or English.
We got one question in Swedish. Is it okay?
Yes, of course.
Hur tror du utvecklingen kommer se ut om 5-10 år? Var kommer vi vara då?
Ja, jag tror att som jag svarade lite på Mohammeds fråga innan där, så jag tror att det kommer att ske ett skifte här, och det finns stora potentialer. Sen är det ju svårt att säga inom vilken del det här är, men till exempel det exemplet med waste to taste, att producera vegetabiliska gröna proteiner, där tror jag det kommer att hända mycket, och där tycker jag att det är ett ypperligt exempel det som man har tagit fram i Borås här, att bygga vidare på. Så där tror jag absolut att vi kommer att se produkter som kommer att komma ut. Och jag hoppas att den här typen av också att förbättra de här värdekedjorna som vi har pratat om här också, för att minska råvaruproduktionen eller råvarukonsumtionen, verkligen kommer att få stor kraft. Och det tror jag verkligen.
Ja, verkligen jättespännande och jätteintressant. Vi får tacka dig, Andreas, för den här otroligt intressanta föreläsningen. För er som har tittat så kan jag berätta att vi också kommer lägga upp, vad heter det, hela föreläsningen i sin helhet på hb.se framöver. Tack så hemskt mycket.
Tack så mycket.